Fellow members, good morning. It's the appointed time and there is a quorum. Let's call the meeting to order. First, applications for late membership. Mr. Gary FAN on the 18th of May has asked to join the subcommittee. In accordance with Article 23 bracket C of the House Rules, so I would like to ask the members whether you accept this application. Any views? Agree? So welcome Mr. Gary FAN. The second item. Now there are, well, after Mr. Gary FAN joins, we have a total of 37 members. And the quorum for meetings is 12. Next, government paper. On the 23rd of May, the government submitted its paper to the Secretariat. I believe that some members may not have gone through them, and maybe they have not adequately prepared. So I'd like to ask the government that in future you should submit your papers as early as possible. I know that maybe at times many documents would have to be submitted, but if you can submit the papers as soon as you can to members, then members get to understand more about the issues and ask questions accordingly. Yes? A moment, please. Mrs. Regina, you raised your hand first. Yes, it's me who raised my hand first. Mrs. Virginia Yip, Chairman, I know that there is going to be a public hearing soon, and we are now discussing the way forward. Now, for Link, and it has divested two times its properties or assets to different investors. I understand that many investors may not have experience in managing shopping centers. Some of the shopping centers are refurbished and modified in a Tin Market in Wong Tai Shin in East Kowloon is a good example. There is no shopping center, no Chinese restaurant in the refurbished shopping center, and people have to shop or buy groceries for the elderly living there. So there's an investor called Lam Chi Fong, and he uses different companies to buy the properties. And so can we ask them to come and tell us how they manage the shopping centers? The housing authority has that responsibility. The judgment is that even though the properties have been sold off, the housing authority still has the duty to have certain control over such a facility so that they will be enjoyed by the residents. So for some of the facilities, they have been demolished for 2 years and there is no replacement facility. So how can that be?
We jot down your comments. And next, Mr. Eddie Chu. Chairman, on the 26th of March, I've put in a request for the administration to make available 7 papers or 7 reports regarding the sale and purchase arrangement. I'd like to confirm with you, Mr. Chairman, whether the seeking of the 7 reports fall within the remit of this committee. If you find these agreeable, then it follows that the administration has to be made available. The administration argued otherwise. Just for example, the chief executive imposition of service agreement. Now, they said that this report has got nothing to do with this committee. This service agreement drawn up by the top dog of the link, how is it that irrelevant to this committee? Mr. Zhu, you made a request with the administration. You didn't do so with my agreement. It wasn't for me to make the request, Mr. Zhu. Chairman, I made a request through the secretariat. I didn't do it myself. You said with the consent of the chairman. Mr. Zhu, unless the chairman confirms that the requests fall within the remit of the committee, he will not be referring this to the administration. Under normal circumstances, when the secretariat receives any suggestions from members, it would refer the comments to the administration and seek the relevant information. I am aware of that. The secretariat merely conveyed your views. According to the administration, some of the requests fall outside the remit of the committee. They said none of the requests fall within the remit. You've seen that. Do you agree that this also falls outside the remit? Our remit is very clear. If you don't have the remit, the terms of reference, I can make available a copy to you. You might wish to have a good look at it. I don't want to engage you in a debate here. And I can call upon the administration to make a response. Yes, please tell me why it is so compliant with the terms of reference. There are 7 papers that I'm seeking. All right, then I'd like to ask the administration to make a response first. Why is it that it is, in your opinion, that they fall outside the remit of this committee? Chairman, thank you. I appreciate Mr. Zhu's concerns. Now, the papers that you seek are basically when the link read in 2005 was. Sorry, I'd like to confirm this. There are 2 letters, 9th of March. I saw the sale and purchase agreement. Did you agree to make this available, or have you agreed to this being made available? Now this is out of the way. Now I'm dealing with the March 26th request. Thank you, Mr. Zhu. March 9th, you wrote a letter to seek a copy of the sale and purchase agreement. In our reply to LegCo Secretariat, we've made the point that there are 3 papers, HA in 2004, November, and it was the sale and purchase agreement, Link Property Limited and HA in 2005, September 6th, there was a supplement to the sale and purchase agreement, Link Property Limited and HA on the 3rd of November 2005, entered into an appendix to this agreement. We made available an e-version of the papers to the secretariat by way of a CD-ROM. The Honourable Member said that on March 26, he sought information regarding in 2005, during the IPO, you'd like to have the link documents at that time. The documents refer to the employment terms for the chief executive and also the transition arrangement for the link, and also the underwriter's commitment. In 2005, November, the listing has been done and has become a listed company, and it is our view that the documents has got nothing to do with the operating situations of the shopping centers, markets, and car parks in PRH and HOS estates. Mr. Ji, I'd like to seek confirmation. I said that the employment terms of the chief executive, why are they irrelevant to the management situation? You must, though, like Mrs. Regina Ip said, there are problems there. Are the terms invalid now? If the terms are still valid, why are they not relevant? Well, those were the employment terms at that time. It's been a decade or so link in terms of the employment situation, the structure, the recruitment. They are using terms and they may be different from those in those years. I'd like to say also that the IPO has been completed and Link is an independent entity. The operation conditions, the employment terms, and the strategic decisions about the properties and day-to-day management and leasing arrangement, these are the things handled by an independent entity. And this subcommittee is tasked to look at the shopping centers, markets and car parks in PRH. Right, hang on a sec. Right. Mr. Chu, I don't really want to have these to-ing and fro-ing between you and the administration. After today's meeting, you might wish to go through with the secretariat and see which one of them fall within the remit of this committee and which do not. And we take it like this, okay? Dr. Kwok-wai, Chairman, are we talking about the way forward or are we done with it? I'm going to get on to the way forward, right? I save my remarks till then. All right, way forward. Before we get on to that, we were talking about the requests for papers. I have received a lot of requests from members, and I've put this to the administration. Various members have, through the secretariat, sought additional documents from the administration. The volume is rather large. I feel that there are some papers that members have direct access to without going through the secretariat. The administration would have to get hold of documents from certain entities themselves. And we don't really want to see any papers being made available very late. If we are seeking public documents, we may wish to seek them ourselves instead of doing it through the administration. Mr. Xu Kafai, well, Chairman, I agree with you. It depends on what kind of documents we are talking about. If there are documents that are in the public domain, we don't have to impose this upon the administration. And if the volume is large, my colleagues would assist me. But I think the document sought should be relevant to this committee. The secretariat should look at the requests and see whether they are relevant, because too big a volume would hamper our work. Mr. Yu Xiwing, Chairman, I go along with Mr. Xiu. Now, the documents, the covenants and so on, the sheer volume is really staggering. And if members are seeking a vast amount of documents, it may take the administration time to put them together. Like you said, some of the papers are made available late, and they have to go through the papers with us. Like Dr. Kwok-wai said, we have to look at the way forward, which is a more important thing. If we seek all the documents and try to attach responsibilities, then it would limit our room for further discussion. Dr. K.K. Kwok, Chairman, there are two types of documents. The first one is in the public domain to facilitate members. The administration may not print everything off. Like the lady from the administration said, they made available the papers in CD-ROM that would facilitate our assistants and ourselves to read the public documents. Before this committee was formed, it would be difficult for us to get hold of the relevant documents from the administration. Like the land leases, they're reluctant to make them available until such time as this committee has been formed. Some members are terribly busy. They may have no time to go through them. But if subject to members' endorsement, if we are seeking certain documents, that the availability of documents that will hamper our operation, members will not normally individually seek papers from the administration. I think with the availability of members, they can exercise their judgment about them. All the papers sought for the purpose of this subcommittee. I haven't seen any requests that are excessive. But I think with the endorsement of the committee, we can seek the papers. Mr. Adichie, Chairman, the paper for today is an example. Mrs. Regina Ip and other members would like to have some background information. And these are two different things. We're not imposing any deadline for them to make available the papers. But if they can do so, it will facilitate our understanding of the issue. It's up to you whether you like to go through the papers in detail. But at least this, the mission of this subcommittee is for us to understand the whole thing from inside out. And I hope that we can build on this foundation. It doesn't matter if the number of papers is large. More is far better than less. Well, I heard your requests. If you'd like to have background information about housing estates and the car parks, the government should make them available. For covenants, there is nothing much that will be added. Members can seek them in order to lighten the burden on the administration. Members might wish to approach the relevant parties direct. That's what I heard from the administration. So that's how we take it forward.
Say, for example, for land leases, are you asking us to buy the land leases ourselves or what? Can you those upstairs please keep quiet? Now? We talk about the DMC, the land leases, and other issues related to management and also agreements between the government and the landlords. And they have been registered in the land registry, and you have to buy them, say, at a cost of $100 to $200. Maybe I buy some myself, and Mrs. Virginia buys some others, and we are spending on this for the same documents. Are we? Not very often, we don't have exchanges, and I can't force her to hand over her documents for me to take a look. So that's very strange. I think land leases form the basis of our discussion. And you said that, well, if we don't want the public to have a look, then we will buy them ourselves. But then I think it's a better approach is to ask them to give us, and then that can be shared among the members of the subcommittee. Maybe you are not aware of how much we're spending to buy, say, the land leases with an encumbrance imposed upon them. And we are buying, say, thousands of dollars every month. We are talking about public funds here. Isn't it a waste of money? Well, for the legislature, I think we are squandering a lot of public money. Well, if you continue to shout upstairs, maybe I'll ask you to leave. Mrs. Regina Yip. Chairman, let me suggest this. Say if legislators raise the name of a specific housing estate where there has been a breach, affecting people's interest, maybe there is a flyover, a footbridge, or a dental clinic disappearing, and so on. So we can ask for documents on that. It's just like myself. Maybe I've received complaints, and I find I bought some of the documents myself. But so if we want to ask for documents from the government, maybe we can be more specific. So if you give me all the information of all on all housing estates, I will not have time to go through all of them. Dr. Kwok-wai, let's not take a cross-board approach. Later on, we are going to have a public hearing. And honestly, some tenants of the estates don't know about the ins and outs of the divested of the shopping arcades there, and it's unreasonable for us to ask the residents to buy the land leases themselves, say at a cost of $100 or so. So I agree with Mrs. Yip's suggestion. Let's use a more targeted approach. And there is another lot of 17 shopping centers being divested, and 16 are affected, and I think these are important shopping centers, and we should take a look at these the documents of these shopping centers. We should help the shop owners and the tenants. And Chairman, if you say that we are not going to seek documents from the government anymore, the government would be very happy about that. So if we think the documents are important and will help our discussion, then that we should do so. We will not casually ask for documents. We would only do that when there is a need. Dr. Junius Ho, I agree that we should not take up the work of what others should be doing. Now, if we cast the net too wide, I would say that we will miss our overall goals. Now, in the document, in relation to our responsibility of monitoring the divestment of properties, as mentioned by Dr. KK Kwok under the Housing Ordinance, what is the HA's role in monitoring link, and what is the government's role in doing that? And say if there is divestment and in relation to land leases modifications, what is our role in monitoring that? Now, on these several issues, I believe that the government knows well that we are concerned about these. Now, for the properties divested by link, we may express our views, and in relation to land leases and covenants, and are there any is there any monitoring measures and so on, and please give us the documents, and we know that what we can do. Say, for example, if the agreements entered into in the past, there is nothing much we can do, then, well, that's it. So we should tackle it from that perspective. We should not ask for all documents, and then we will go through them. Now, I think the HA has a legal team, and they should come up with their views on certain matters, then that we can have a more focused discussion. Mr. Gary Fan, the subcommittee's role is to monitor the properties divested by link and whether the buyers and the conglomerates are breaching the land leases. And the chairman said that there are two streams of thought, and you said that we should not be asking for all sorts of documents. Well, if we are not doing it centrally, then the secretariat's workload would be increased. Say, if different members try to do it in their own way, and then we have to share our information with the secretariat and other members, then there would be a lot of difficulties as far as discharging our duties are concerned, and it will put a heavy workload on the secretariat. I think the subcommittee should, as a whole, seek documents from the administration, and the documents should be well numbered, and the land leases should be well numbered to facilitate the work of the subcommittee, and then committee members would know what they're up to, what their questions are among themselves. Mr. Xu Ka Chen, I agree with Mrs. Regina Yip's proposal of taking a middle of the road approach. I would like to seek clarification on what you said. You said that we asked for documents that will pose heavier pressure on the administration. I think we should be concerned about that. I'm only concerned about adding extra workload to the secretariat. I don't think what you said is correct. We should not care about adding extra workload to the government. And secondly, you said that the legislature has squandered public resources. I don't understand that. Mr. Eddie G said that if I try to see information, Mrs. Regina Yip is seeking the same, then it will be a waste of resources. But then you responded by saying that the legislature is already squandering public funds. What do you mean by that? Can you clarify? Dr. Chen Chung Tai? Well, we should get one thing clear. Now, whether Link was listed way back and whether it was divesting its assets and re-divesting its assets, we are talking about shopping centers and markets in PRH estates. So in the nature of such facilities are public facilities, and the legislature and the administration should take responsibility for all these. Now, it used to be the Link grid, now it is Link, and it would not be that because of that our responsibility is weakened, or and it would not be the case that we should buy the land leases ourselves. Mrs. Regina Yip is asking that we steer the middle course. But I don't subscribe to that. As pointed out by Mr. Xiu Ka-chun, if the secretariat has a heavier workload, we'll try to help them out. But for the housing department, it is recruiting many more people this year. And why do you have to care about whether they have a hard time? And, well, the former government officials insisted that the link could be listed, and we are seeing the mess today. And I think we are, what you propose, what some members propose, is trying to restrict our own power. I don't think we should spend time discussing it. These are public resources, and we have the duty to monitor them. Mr. Yu Si-wing, I agree with Mrs. Yip's proposal. So if members ask for all covenants to be shown to us, so they may be in hundreds in number, do we need them really? So maybe we can ask the members why they are asking for these covenants before they are given to us, and that would be better because it would not add extra burden to the secretariat. I think this is a more pragmatic and feasible approach. Well, normally the members would have heard that there is a problem with a certain estate, and he's asking for documents related to that estate. And I think that documents should only be required under that circumstance. Mr. Leung Yew-chung and Mrs. Regina Yip, I'll draw a line here. Mr. Leung Yew-chung. Thank you, Chairman. Well, I've attended meetings, many meetings, But I've seldom heard the saying that if we ask for documents, then the government will have a heavier workload. And second, we seldom did we hear that legislators were asked to buy our own documents. Over the years, I've never heard suggestions like that. And thirdly, why are legislators asking for information but then of documents, but then our request is declined? Well, unless there are special reasons and documents will not be provided. The legislators are serving Hong Kong people, and the government has a duty to supply documents requested by members. Of course, there are many districts in Hong Kong, and there are so many papers, and I understand and appreciate your concern about adding extra workload to government officials. Can we steer a middle course? Don't tell me that it's a waste of resources and there will be work pressure, extra work pressure, and use those as pretext for not giving the information. I don't believe that legislators would ask for documents unreasonably, and I think they will only ask for documents when there is indeed a need. So maybe the Secretariat can talk to the legislators to see whether the documents requested are really needed. Chairman, you suggested that Mr. Eddie Jude should talk to the relevant people first, and I think that's a reasonable or appropriate approach, or else we will be undermining our capacity as legislators. Mrs. Regina Yip, I'll be very simple here. I think it's useful to get, say, land leases, DMCs, etc. Yesterday, I received the reply from the Director of Lands, and it is said that many car parks under link are in breach of the land leases. I can share the information with the Secretariat and also members here. And I would suggest that we receive complaints all the time, so we can work on the estates whereby complaints have been received. We can set priorities ourselves. So, Chairman, can I ask you to share this paper with or reply with other members? Mr. Frankie Yick, well, those upstairs, please keep quiet. I'm last warning you for the last time. If you shout again, I will order you immediately out of the meeting room. Mr. Frankie has not spoken, so I'll give him the time to speak. Thank you, Chairman. I joined this subcommittee because I believed that people, members are not happy with the present situation. We want to help the tenants. But then I noticed that the legislators recently have been asking all sorts of information from the administration. I wonder whether members really read through them. If there is a need, of course, it's right for us to ask for documents. I think what we talk about was history, and I believe that the government will gatekeep on any divestment activities of Link. And I agree with Mrs. Yip that where problems are identified, we should deal with those problems in a targeted way. Even if you've got the information or papers, you won't be able to change the reality, right? So I say, summing up the views made by members, I'm just responding to those views.
When I talk about the pressure faced by the administration, if you make the request, they have to do it. Like today, some of the papers were made available on the 23rd. We have some background information there. If they do not provide us with the papers on time, as per members' requests, then members would grumble about the practice, and that may be a wasteful use of our time. If the administration can have sufficient time to prepare the papers for us, then it would be conducive to better discussion. I heard clearly what members' views are. I wouldn't say what papers would be justified or not, but according from what I heard from different members, members agree with Mrs. Regina Yip that we should be given the background of the topics. We would look at the information, and members can make the request with the secretariat, and then we pass on the request to the administration. All right, way forward. Members have all the topics with you. And tabled before members are letters from some of the members. So please have a look. And I'd like to hear from members their views regarding the public hearing, regarding the different topics that will be on the queue for discussion. Dr. Kwokaki, 2 points, Chairman. The most urgent business is to have a public hearing to discuss the 16 housing estates that the administration divested to the one of the operators. The market, I mean, the situation is in a mess. Some of them are run by short-term contracts. It would be very hard for the market traders. It's very hard for them to make a business decision whether they should stock up for the shops, because within 3 months they might be chucked out. And also the car park users, they are worried about the rent being put up any time. Chairman, I understand that there is going to be a public hearing, and I hope that you would follow the topics when scheduling the public hearings. If you want to deal with the 16 estates or HOS estates that have been divested, we should focus our attention on these. There are 16 housing estates and HOS estates. Welfare facilities, in particular the social welfare organizations, over the years they have been suffering a great deal at the hands of Link. We don't have sufficient information. We don't have sufficient response to all these problems. If a public hearing were to be held, I think, Chairman, you should allow the deputations to discuss different topics. Things are terribly complicated. For the markets, I'm not talking about the 17. What about those that have not been divested? What about those that have been divested last time? They have different needs and requirements. So when you deal with the public hearings, please do not invite them in a single lot, because that doesn't help matters. Link has created so many problems now, and there are problems piled up for the future. I hope that there would be sufficient time for the deputations with a proper involvement. All right, 3 minutes for this round of debate each. Mr. Adichie, Chairman. A moment ago, Dr. K.K. Kwok talked about Gore Capital and the car park facilities, and they have the 3 month freeze period. They don't know what they are letting themselves in for after the 1st of June. So we should have a public hearing on these people first, and then we should invite Gore Capital to come along and discuss with us. I heard also from Mrs. Regina Ip that Lam Chi Fong and Fushan, I'm wondering whether we can invite them all as well. I find this agreeable. I find myself in agreement with that. But to start off with, we should invite those affected in the 17 estates first. Mrs. Regina Ip, Chairman Link has divested the properties, some to Gore Capital, some to other investors who refurbished the facilities. And the facilities were out of action for 2 years, and they talked about international school, but that didn't get off the ground. Some talked about old folks' homes, and we'll have to bring in the investors as well. One of the residents saw me searching the deeds, and they said that they're running out of facilities. They should ask the conglomerates to make available the facilities to them. Under the Housing Ordinance, we do have the obligation to secure the provision of amenities ancillary to the housing estates. That there is also the infestation of rodents, and things are really getting undesirable, so we have to bring these people along here. Dr. Ching Chung Tai, Chairman. Now, this re-divestment by Link has a bearing on the traders of the markets, and we have to follow up on the tendencies of these market traders. There were comments about unequal agreements. And with these divestment or re-divestment, it would be hard for us to get to grips with the situation. So in terms of the tendencies, we have to learn more about the conditions in them and follow up on them. Market management is another issue. Management can be discussed as a general issue, or alternatively, we can specifically discuss the vacancy in the link markets, because that would make a difference to whether government markets will be provided in the vicinity, like Tin Shui Wai, and all these have to be taken into account as a whole in terms of policy formulation. So the vacancy rate and management of the link markets should be highlighted for discussion. We can take these two first. I save my other comments till later. Mr. Jonathan Ho, I go along with Mrs. Regina Ip. Many investors do not procure these properties for rental purposes. They may be doing so for speculative purposes. So these investors should be invited along to have a dialogue with us. Also, some members said that we should hold the public hearings along the lines of the owners. I think they go by the same sale and purchase agreements for everything. This may cover the car parks, shopping malls, and markets. I think we should divide the public hearings along those lines instead of lumping them all together. Mr. Wilson Orr, Chairman, I agree that we should have the public hearings. It would not be sufficiently comprehensive to have Gore Capital alone, because there have been so many investors and buyers that have bought into the divested properties. Unless we don't invite them, if we do so, we have to invite them all for us to have a comprehensive understanding. Also, members talked about management, markets, and so on. I feel that two things should be highlighted. The first is the residents should enjoy the facilities that they should be entitled to. There are some facilities that well and truly dead. They're not viable. And secondly, for the car parks, there are some parking spaces that are divested. We find, to our surprise, that in some parking facilities, they would sell the parking spaces of others. They do not. The administration told us that they are acting in accordance with the covenant. And I hope that in the public hearing, I would like to hear from the stakeholders, straight from the horse's mouth, of what the situation is really all about. Thank you. Mr. Shukafai, Chairman, thank you. I say many times, and I say again, that it was a mistake for the government to divest the properties to Link. But there is no going back. There are traders who are evicted. There are people in the housing estates and who cannot secure any parking facilities. And this is a regular occurrence. Now, there was a shopping mall that was sold to an investor, and the operation has been leaving a lot to be desired. And it's so inconvenient for the residents there. If we can hold public hearings, we can allow them to air their views. It would be only good. And that way we can identify ways to help them. It would be too late to build new ones, but for the existing ones, I think we ought to come up with ways and means to help the residents who are using these facilities, which are subsidized by the administration. Mr. Leung Yu-chung, other than public hearings, we should be concerned about markets, car parks, and we should also be concerned about the open space and the amenities facilities. The Link hardly ever carries out many repair and maintenance, and some of them are closed. The other thing is the repair and maintenance of the common area. Link or the owners do not carry out any work there. The housing department cannot do anything unless with their consent. But many a time, if they are reluctant to do it, then the housing department would be sitting idly by, and repair and maintenance of these common areas leaves so much to be desired. Third, management. The housing estates and the shopping malls are linked together. Link doesn't work in cooperation with the management companies. And there are so many problems. Like Mrs. Virginia Ip said, there are rodents, infestation. There are a whole host of other problems I hope that the committee would be concerned about.
Mrs. Virginia Ip. Chairman, I will be very brief in this second round. Now, I don't think the problem can be resolved by holding a public hearing. Some residents have complained to me in Chang Kwan O in NT East in Cho Lam Estate. Well, there are triad members actually operating there, say they have put in bids for cleansing work, and residents know about this, but they dare not report to the police for fear of being beaten up by the triad members. So please pay attention to that. All right, so we will hold a public hearing next time. I've heard different views of members. Some are asking for the public hearings to be divided into different sessions, and others have asked for investors to be invited, past and present and future investors, etc. So I have this suggestion. Now, for these three subject matters, shopping centers, markets, and car parks, Well, maybe investors are under different classes as well. Number one, we don't know whether they are willing to come, and we are not sure how many times they are willing to come. It gets too complicated. I mean, our portfolio is very wide. So in the public hearing, people can express views on shopping centers, markets, and car parks in relation to management issues. And also, users can express their views on operation, refreshment, rental of link properties, etc. And for car parks, some mentioned have talked about different ways of selling car parking spaces of it as well. So if there's no other view, then we will send letters to invite the stakeholders, including the investors, members of the public, the management companies, etc. We welcome all these parties to come and give their views at the public hearing. Dr. Kwokaki, well, I mean, the scope that you suggest is too wide. We give the deputations 3 minutes only, and then you talk about shopping centers, markets, and car parks. Well, let's not do it this way, Chairman. Well, unless you host many, many public hearings, what is most pressing, as I mentioned, is the 16 shopping centers which have been sold off. I agree with what you said as to the coverage, but then if these are lumped together, we will lose the focus. For the 16 shopping centers, I mean, they have been, they've been doomed in a way. And we talk about different stakeholders involved in different, say, shopping centers, welfare facilities, and so on. Well, if you fear that the investors don't come, then maybe we can have a special meeting with the investors, like the Gore Capital. We can have a discussion with them only. And they are involved in many different venues. So let's not lump the members of the public and the investors together. And what matters most is the 16 shopping centers. How can you cover so much in one public hearing? No, that can't be possible. Mr. Porter, I agree that because we talk about a wide scope here, and then district councillors all over Hong Kong will be very concerned. Now, going by our past experience, if we cover too many topics, maybe we can divide the public hearings into different sessions, and then there are two parts. One is for the deputations to give views, and the administration can give a response. We should adopt a more focused approach. If we cover so many topics in one public hearing, we will lose the focus. Now, we talk about inviting potential investors and investors. My feeling is that investors would not come because they would like to maximize their profits. I think that kind of suggestion may be too naive. And well, we've received many complaints against Link's approach, but then if we ask investors to come, maybe they would be subject to an open trial-like type of meeting here. So I don't think that's a style of Hong Kong. I have reservation on that suggestion. Mr. Jonathan Ho, maybe the Secretariat can help try to ascertain the situation. Maybe we should not target the investors per se. And Dr. Kwokaki that said that we should talk about these 16 shopping centers, but then for these 16 venues, all the three kinds of facilities are covered. And maybe we can adopt a more focused approach by having one for shopping centers, the other for markets, and the other for car parks, and we can discuss the administration's role in that. And we should not target individual parties, say, Link and individual investors, and we should not hold a special public hearing for them. That's not reasonable. And I'm also concerned about whether we have the time and the venues to hold all these public hearings proposed. So let us do it this way. Let's have three types of facilities for our public hearing. One is shopping centers, markets, and car parks. So the subcommittee covers these three facilities. Maybe we can have three public hearings to be held on 3 days. Then that shouldn't be a problem. And any stakeholder related to these facilities can come. And we will have an open invitation. They can join the public hearing and give and air their views. So I would ask the clerk to arrange that, subject to any further views of members. Mr. Leung Yu-chung, I don't oppose your suggestion, but I raise a question about management, recreation facilities, management of common areas, etc. These are important facilities for tenants. But then Link turns a blind eye to all these issues, and there are so many problems with management. So how are you going to deal with this? When will we deal with these? Well, let's first deal with the facilities as stated in the name of the subcommittee. Of course, there are many other issues related to PRH estates. For issues falling outside our ambit, let's deal with them later on. Well, if there is a public hearing, anybody who comes can talk about anything related to shopping centers, markets, and car parks. I think this is open and transparent. Well, so let's work on the public hearings first. If we continue to debate on this, I don't think we are going anywhere. Mr. Shukar Chun, I don't want to argue with you. You talk about three public hearings on shopping centers, markets, and car parks respectively. I think that's really the basic requirement. And a member said that, suggested that we can take reference from the Subcommittee on Ethnic Minority Group, and there will be two parts to the public hearings. One is for the deputations to give views, the other is for the administration to talk over the issues. And we talk about rodent problems, management issues, and so on. And I think these should also be covered, but I will not be insisting on my own way. Mr. Wilson Orr, I accept your proposal of the three public hearings, and that's a comprehensive. But I agree with Mr. Leung Yu-chung that, say, members of the public, in particular the PRH tenants, facing the lack of social welfare facilities after the divestment of the properties. So if another public hearing can be held on that, then I would fully support that. Maybe you said that these can be discussed at some other occasions. But in any case, I would suggest that these issues should be covered. Well, you agree that we should hold public hearings as soon as possible. So the next meeting will be a public hearing, and there will be three sessions. One is shopping center, one on market, and the last one on car park. And then we will be hearing a lot of different views at the public hearings. And on the views received, then we can discuss those at subsequent meetings. And there is an item listed in the list of outstanding items, and that is on the buying back Link and the properties under Link. That can be discussed after the public hearing. Now, for views heard at the public hearings, which members find worthy of further discussion and handling, then that can be arranged later. So that's it. shall we do it that way? Okay. The next item is the Hong Kong Housing Authority's regulation of divested properties under the Housing Ordinance, Cap 283. So maybe the administration can walk us through this paper and you can share information with us. Thank you, Chairman and members. Good morning. I'd like to thank the subcommittee for inviting the government team to attend this meeting, since the Undersecretary for Transport and Housing is on leave this weekend. He can't be here. And attending this meeting, including myself and other government officials, we explain the issue and respond to members' questions. And after the meeting, I will also relate members' views to the Undersecretary. In fact, the government has, at various occasions at the electrical, the HA's duties under the Housing Ordinance to secure the provision of amenities ancillary to the housing facilities as the authority thinks fit. A list of the relevant documents have been listed, and that is these is listed in footnote 1. And paragraph 4 mentions that the CFA in 2005 has made a judgment on a related judicial review case. The HA should secure the provision of relevant facilities. That doesn't mean that the HA should directly provide or own such facilities. In other words, the HA had already secured the provision of such facilities, even if they were provided by a third party. And the CFA noted that a market-oriented commercial approach would be adopted in operating the divested properties. And we have explained many times that the for divestment of properties is subject to legal requirements, land lease conditions, and the relevant restrictive covenants. And paragraphs 6 to 17 list out all the relevant regulations. And paragraph 7 mentions that owners of divested properties, like other property owners, shall comply with the relevant laws, say, for example, the Buildings Ordinance, the Town Planning Ordinance, and so on. And para 8 and 9 said something about land lease conditions. It would normally, land leases will talk about the use and the various land uses on the relevant plots. And paragraphs 10 to 11 says the DMC. DMC talks about the maintenance of common areas and recreational facilities, etc., and that the landowner should comply with the relevant conditions. And paragraphs 12 to 17 list the restrictive covenants, which cover that said that under certain conditions that resale facilities and car parking facilities should not be disposed of except as a whole. And the for under the welfare letting covenant, the divested property shall be let out to non-profiting making organizations nominated by the nominating authorities as concessionary rent or market rent for welfare or education facilities. And paragraph 18 sets out the fact that as long as the relevant legal requirements and land lease conditions are complied with, the government and the HA cannot interfere with the owner's lawful right to use their properties, including the day-to-day operation and commercial decisions, including disposal of properties, leasing arrangements, etc.
However, if we find that there are breaches of the leases, then the department and the housing authority will take this seriously and pursue the matter vigorously. In terms of day-to-day management, if there are breaches of the leases or the DMC or the legislation, we would refer the matters to the DMC managers, owners corporation, and the relevant DLOs for follow-up. Following the last meeting, in response to members' requests, we have made available papers regarding our response on the 26th of March, and also the divestment of the deeds and various responses by the administration, we feel that some of the documents are irrelevant, like Mr. Eddie Chu sought papers regarding the employment conditions, terms of the CEO and underwriters' details. These papers are irrelevant to this subcommittee on shopping centers, markets, and car parks. So we have not made available these papers. I hope the members would understand these. So much I have to say for the time being. Thank you. Thanks very much, Deputy Director of Housing. Under 83A of the Rules of Procedure, if members have any pecuniary interests, direct or indirect, regarding what we discussed today, you're supposed to disclose the nature of the interests before you take the floor. All right, 3 minutes and now for each member, Mr. Jonathan Ho. Chairman, I find the response a little bit surprising. Paragraph 14, there are car parks that have been divested, Heng Tin, Tin Peng Estates. They have sold individual car parks. Why do you say that they shall not dispose of them except as a whole? Have you forgotten about this altogether? They have to rent the car parks to those living in the housing estates, but the fact remains that there are outsiders who are using the car parks. Why do you write paragraph 14 the way you did, and paragraph 4, Tima Court, Heng Tin Kwong Tin Estates, they have been divested to new owners, and somehow they're not doing so for rental purposes. They're not trying to attract more traders in. They don't want to revitalize the estates. Tima Court has been lying vacant for 2 years. Kwong Tin, Tin Peng Estates are also cases in point. I get the feeling that they are trying to speculate on the facilities. So are we able to enforce or implement the requirements of the CFA that the Housing Authority has the obligation to ensure provision of the amenities? At the early stage, one shopping mall may be serving a catchment area of two or three housing estates, and now people have to walk about 20 minutes to the next housing estate for the service. That there are facilities that have been lying vacant for so long. How are you going to deal with this? Deputy Director, thank you. Thanks very much, Mr. Jonathan Ho. Your questions cover a broad spectrum of things. First of all, the housing ordinance, I'd like to say this again. As I said in my introductory remarks, I said that under the Housing Ordinance, Section 41 provides for the objectives of the Housing Authority. It has to secure the provision of housing and amenities ancillary to housing. In 2005, the CFA handed down the ruling. But please do not read them out for me. I'm saying that they're lying vacant and they're not coming in for rental purposes and they leave them vacant. Can you deal with this? Deputy Director, be more specific. Some of them have been divested already. Vice Chairman Ho's question is very direct. Can you address the question direct, please? Deputy Director, yes, you mentioned the divested car parks. In general, in the car park governance, it requires that the facilities shall not be disposed of except as a whole. Now, when they sign the sale and purchase agreement, they have to impose this restrictive covenant. when the housing authority sells or disposes of the facilities, this covenant will not apply. Deputy Director, I'm not sure whether you are saying or whether you are with me. Apparently, Heng Tin Estate or Tin Peng Estate, they have been divested. And in paragraph 14, are you saying something that is not consistent with what's happening? Have you got it wrong? Didi, well, you mentioned the housing estates, the residential units have been disposed of, and talk about the car park. Yes, there is a restrictive covenant on the car park when a housing estate units have been divested, then the restrictive covenant on the housing estate will not be enforced. In other words, they can sell the unit, the car parks separately. I'm talking about the rental housing estates. Yes, Mr. Xu Ka-chun, paragraph 16. After divesting, there cannot be extra management fees that can be charged. But I was told that after divestment, the new owner required these welfare organizations to pay renovation fees. There is an NGO pre-primary school that was asked for a fee in payment of a renovation. Housing Authority has received 5 complaints in this category. I'm sure you know the number. My question for the administration is this. For the new owners, they collect a rent from the welfare organizations and management fees. What other fees can they not collect? Can they only charge the rent from the welfare organizations alone? For the 17 shopping malls that have been divested, I've talked with the Social Welfare Department, Education Department, and the Housing Department. I found that you never had any communication with the organizations. Do you have any mechanism to follow up on the leasing arrangement for these welfare organizations? My question is very straightforward. I hope that you will answer me direct. Deputy Director, Chairman, thank you, Mr. Xu, for the question. For the divested properties and the welfare facilities, if the welfare facilities are bound by the welfare letting covenants, the new owners in the divested properties can only collect the welfare rental from the users. In other words, they can only charge the rental at the designated level. The management fee would have been incorporated into this, and there will be no other extra that the welfare organization have to pay, Mr. Xu. Renovation charges will not be collected. Well, you talk about the decanting and renovation, I don't have the information with me. Now, for the welfare letting covenant, it has provided that the landlord can only collect the welfare rental. What about your communication with the organizations before and after the purchase? We do have a mechanism when a property is being divested, we would liaise or get in touch with the nominated organization. We would make available the information to them that a property has been divested, and we would let them know that the welfare letting covenant will still remain in force. How far ahead do you engage them for communication? Whenever we know about the divestment, we would get in touch with them. I hope that you would do so as soon as possible.
Thank you.
Renovation, how do you define that? It sounds a little bit vague, whitewashing, or partitioning, or whatever. How do you define renovation? If Mr. Xu has these cases, you might wish to make available more information, like whitewashing the wall, for instance. Do they have to be held responsible, or would it take a larger scale renovation to be called a renovation? And that would enable us to have a better understanding of the situation. Mr. Xu, well, this is in the newspaper. I don't know why the deputy director said that he hasn't got the information. Well, thank you very much. If you can make available the information, I'll follow up. Mr. Gary Fan, chairman, on the 26th of February, there was the supplementary information, CB4A01. It makes it very clear that HOS and TPS assignment deed doesn't include the restrictive covenant for the parking. That's why you said that the car parks can be sold separately, individually to non-residents. How do you monitor the situation to make sure that there would be enough supply of parking facilities for those living in the housing estates? Deputy Director. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Fan. We are just as concerned about the divestment of properties and the implications on day-to-day life. The divestment will have to observe all the land leases, the covenants, and the deeds. Like Mr. Fan said, there may not be any restrictive covenants, and the car parks can be sold separately. Their use will still be subject to the land lease conditions. If ever we identify these problems, any breaches of leases, we would ascertain the situation. If it is established that there is a breach, we would refer them to the land's deed for action. Well, this is my specific question. Does the government have any data bank regarding link? How many of the car parks have been disposed of? Do you have any database for you to assess whether the supply would be adequate? And do you meet them on a regular basis? And if there is not enough supply, would you stop them disposing of the car parks individually? How much have you done in the way of monitoring and supervision? Deputy Director, Chairman, the land lease has all the provisions. I'm sure that the owners have the obligation to abide by them. Deputy Director, please do not repeat what you said. What specifically have you done? Right, let her just finish, please. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. In our day-to-day work for HOS or divested TPS, we would look at complaints. If complaints come through, we will refer them to the relevant departments for action. You don't have a database, do you? Deputy Director, we would go by the land lease. If in the land lease it is specified that X number of car parks have to be provided, they will have to do it.
Well, the land leases will not tell you how many car parking spaces have been divested or disposed of. It only sets the number of parking spaces to be provided. Well, we don't keep such information. If individual owners dispose of their own properties, we don't have the relevant information. Mr. Wilson Orr. Thank you, Chairman. I must declare first that I am a member of the Housing Authority. Now, on this in this meeting, I'm disappointed that nobody from the Policy Bureau is here. HD colleagues may work frontline, but then there is nobody from the Transport and Housing Bureau coming here, and I find this very unacceptable. So please put on record my comment. Second, paragraph 4 of the paper says, quotes the Housing Ordinance, and it is said that HJ is required to secure the provision of housing and such amenities ancillary to the housing facilities. That has been used all along by the government as a shield to ward off our remarks. And when the government wants to do some refurbishment work, Link is asked to pay, that's what we call the UCA fund, and there have been the arguments all along, and it the progress has been slow, and it may take years to complete the relevant projects. And this is something that we face, a problem that we face on a day-to-day basis, and maybe the facilities are very much in need, and the housing department staff can only say maybe pester after Link for a response. And this is this approach is most unhealthy. So going forward, what can you do to improve the situation? That's number one. Number two, now we talk about barrier-free access facilities. Let me quote an example. In Samao Ping, we've been asking for a lift to be installed for over 20 years. So where does the hurdle lie? At Link. And it takes several terms of government before we can resolve the matter. And the residents are in need of BFA facilities. So administration, if the hurdle lies in Link, how will you resolve it? I'll give you some time to respond. Deputy Director, I'd like to thank Mr. Orr for his concern. We are as much as concerned as you are on our daily communication with Link. Let me spend some time to talk about this. Every year, we will, in relation to the use of common areas, repair and maintenance of such areas, meet with the Link on an annual basis, and we will come up with certain agreement on how the funding will be like and what the approach will be. And the mechanism has worked well so far. Now, as for facilities which are broken and need repair and maintenance, and then we count on the ECA funding for such works. Now, Mr. Orr expresses concern about BFA and lifts, and as far as Samoping is concerned, we are closely liaising with Link, and we hope to make certain breakthroughs in the near future. We've been working on this all along. Chairman, you said that the mechanisms worked well. Cite me some examples. At the district, this is not the case. We have the mechanism has not worked smoothly. Maybe after the meeting, I can follow up with you further. Mr. Orr, you can give some cases where the mechanism has not worked for the reference and follow-up duly. Dr. Chen Chung-tai. Thank you, Chairman. In the past few years, Link has been progressively divesting its assets, including car parks, shopping centres and markets. Administration, have you tried to understand, say for example for car parks, whether such divestment is in breach of land leases to the owners and residents? Land leases seem to be the only tool to monitor whether there is non-compliance or breach. And we try to minimize the loss of public resources as a result of divestment. Have you checked on whether the divested car parks are in breach of land leases? Deputy Director, thank you, Dr. Chang, for your concern. You alluded to Link and the new buyers and divesting the properties are in breach of covenants and land leases. We have been checking on that all the time, especially for restrictive covenants, because these are signed directly with the XA. If breaches are identified, as mentioned by Mr. Xiu, say for example for the welfare letting covenants, if we find that new owners are breaching such covenants, we will take action immediately, and there have been remedies implemented. Now, as for car parking and shopping centers, if breaches are identified, we will do several things. First, we will try to ascertain the situation, and then indeed, if there is a breach, we will refer to the cases to the lands department and other government departments to do enforcement. For the information on hand, if we identify such cases, we would advise the relevant parties, and very often the landowners would try to make amends and abide by the covenants. Chairman, we, in relation to welfare letting covenants, the government said that there have been 5 breaches in the past 5 years. But what about car parks? Do you have specific figures? Have you checked on them? If you find that there is no breach, well, tell us so. Or are you waiting for complaints to be lodged before you do anything? Well, my question is, have you taken the initiative to check on the divested car parks to see whether there are any breaches of land leases? Deputy Director. Thank you, Dr. Zhang. On divestment of car parks, we have a restrictive covenant on car parks. And if we find that there is any breach, we will take action immediately. So far, we haven't identified any breach. Mr. Lang Yuchong, Chairman. The Deputy Director replied to Mr. Elson Orr. He said that for maintenance and repair work of common areas, I mean, the mechanism has worked well. No, that shouldn't be the case. When we talk to the HD and the management companies, they often say that Link is not willing to do it. What can we do about it? Now, what can we do about it when the Link is not willing to do anything? And then in relation to DMC, in para 10, you said that for the common areas and recreational facilities, the owners are obliged to discharge their responsibility to properly manage and maintain such facilities. If they don't do so, what can you do for, say, recreational facilities like soccer pitches? What does Link do normally? Or they would put up this sign saying that maintenance work is going on and the area is closed off. But then there is no maintenance work going on there, and the facility is closed off for use. And also they put in restrictions on the time whereby the facility is open for public use. So how can we follow up on? To whom can tenants complain about these cases? Deputy Director, I thank Mr. Lang for your concern. And just now, I talked about our daily communication with Link. I said that we do communicate with them on a daily basis. But as far as different districts are concerned, maybe Link may not be responding to requests as fast as we hoped for, and our colleagues are paying attention to that. Mr. Leung talked about management and repair of common areas in recreational facilities in estates. Generally, we will go by the DMC and the relevant responsibilities of the owners set out in the DMC. We will normally take reference from DMC, and if facilities are not opened up by Link for use by tenants, as required, we will ask Link to follow the requirements and open up the facilities ASAP. We understand that, say, for certain facilities like recreation facilities and park, soccer pitches, they may be subject to repair and maintenance, and we will monitor the situation. And after the repair work is done, it should be opened up for use as soon as possible. If they they deploy delaying tactics, and what will you do? Can you make improvement on such cases? The member has cited certain cases whereby a long time is needed to do repair work. And I hope that the administration can address these issues as soon as you can. Now, if you don't have all the information, maybe Mr. Leung, you can give the details of these cases at the district level to the administration. Now, if they don't discharge their responsibility under the DMC, what will you do? Now, who will follow up on such non-compliance cases? Who has the authority to follow up? On Mr. Leung's concern, if individual owners don't discharge their responsibility under the DMC or they breach the DMC, the DMC manager has the authority to enforce to do enforcement work. They can issue letters to the relevant parties, and they can also take legal action as well. Now, for some venues which have to be closed off for repair works, of course, we will take a look at whether it take unnecessary long time for the repair works. Maybe the repair works involve purchase of parts and components, and that will take time. And you can rest assured that frontline officers will monitor the situation, and we will make sure that the facilities will be reopened for use as soon as possible. So if Mr. Leung has cases whereby the repair works take unnecessarily long, then please provide the information to us and we can follow up. Mr. Eddie Ju, my question is, in the paper, and also the Deputy Director also said that the government will go by the land leases, DMC, and restrictive covenants to regulate the divested properties. I don't think you are being exhaustive here. Say, for example, in Tin Wan, the Link shopping center, last year, it was sold off to a Foshan group, and then it was rented later to an international school for providing the international school there. Maybe the international school was misled by the Foshan group. They came up with a design which blatantly breached the land lease, and the car parking spaces was converted into corridors. And the land department said that approval could not be granted to you because there were fewer car parking spaces. And then there was another step involving the Education Bureau. Now, there is this problem. Say, if the international school were smarter, they asked the lawyers to look at the land leases for them, and then they got to the EDB stage. There was this example of if a rezoning is needed at the town planning board, when that was being done, does the housing department have the chance to express its views? It's a shopping center, and it meets with the conditions of the land leases, but then 3.5 stories of this 4-story building will be used for used as an international school, and a lot of shops will be lost as a result.
Will you give your feedback to the Town Planning Board to stop the applications and that would jeopardize the facilities of the shopping malls? Deputy Director. Thank you, Mr. Chu. All these divestments are governed by the Buildings Ordinance. If there are any alterations or any works that would substantially change the structure, then they have to submit plans to the BA, the Buildings Authority. The BA has also authorized the independent inspection section to look at this. Mr. Chu, Chairman, beg your pardon. Assuming that they've cleared all of these, let's say that international school being provided, they've gone through all these procedures, but would you offer your feedback to the Education Bureau in this regard? Deputy Director, we have a centralized mechanism to look at the plans, fire services, lands, planning, education, for that matter, would all be kept in the loop, and they would be advising from their perspectives regarding whether the proposed alterations are in keeping with the requirements, the plan, and so on. The THB has a special unit looking at these kind of applications. So various departments would have their input. I have two more members on the list. I draw a line there, Mr. Junius Ho and Mr. Andrew Wen. Mr. Ho, please. Chairman, thank you. I'd like to put this to the Deputy Director regarding the land lease and also the car parking facilities. Do you have any requirements regarding who the car parks should be sold to? Should they only be restricted to the residents? There is a dearth of parking facilities. When they are disposed of, is there any restriction, any priority being given to the residents? Now, some residents may have moved out, but the car parks are still kept by them. How you deal with a situation like this? Deputy Director. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Ho. A simple reply here. The users of the car parks and the owners of the car parks are two different things altogether. Under the land lease, there is provision regarding who the car parks are meant for. As to the ownership, there is no specific provision there. Mr. Ho, would there be a situation where the rental would be creeping up incessantly because of the lack of supply in the public housing estates? People living there are not particularly well off. They cannot get out of housing ladder, and they may be able to get to buy a car, but they have a hard time getting a car park for themselves. And even if they get a car park, the rent will be put up in a year or so's time. And there is very much a resentment building up. How are you going to guard against this? Deputy Director, thank you. Thanks very much for your concern, Mr. Ho. As I said in my earlier reply, the land lease provides for the users of the car parks, the owners of the parking facilities would have regard to these provisions when entering into the agreement. As to how they fix the rental, it is entirely a commercial decision. It is not for the administration to dictate how they lease the car parks and how they fix the rental level. But the most important thing is that when they are leasing the car parks, they have to fulfill all the land lease conditions. Mr. Ho, if I may, Chairman, beg your pardon, there may be a situation, if I may, which would give rise to problems. The people living up there are paying $2,000, but the rental may be $8,000. Deputy Director, I take note of Mr. Ho's concerns. Last but not least, Mr. Andrew Wan. Following on from the reply, it seems things are really perfect. They have all the requirements to make sure that the ancillary facilities will become available. You have the DMC, the land lease conditions, and you have the restrictive covenant across so many different areas. But there are still problems. Where are the problems lying? There are 17 estates that have been divested to a fund. You've divested some of them earlier. And we have seen all these problems again and again, like they sold the parking car parks separately. They disposed of the rental units individually. Where are the problems? Are the buyers and sellers aware of the restrictive covenants, the DMC, the land lease conditions? They must have a team. They must be in the picture. They must be buying for rental purposes. They must be buying for investment purposes. Why do we still have all these problems? The department, the housing authority, or the government as a whole, do you have a role? Have you reviewed why you allow the situation or the problems to arise? My second question is this. Mr. Leung Yu-chung put a question, which is important, which is happening. Shek Lei Estate, for instance, recently they have divested, or before Link did so, they have dismantled some of the facilities, like the children's play facilities. I think they may be taking advantage of a loophole. When the facilities are no longer in existence, they don't have any responsibility anymore. Is there anything you can do to plug these kind of loopholes and these are what I call irregularities? Can you not do anything about it? Also, the restrictive covenants and the sell and purchase agreements, I haven't seen them at all. Can the administration make them available? Are they confidential? Deputy Director, thank you. Thanks very much, Mr. Andrew Wan, for your concerns and questions. Three parts to your question. When Link was listed, there were a whole host of regulatory measures, and they have to observe the land lease and the DMCs. We noticed after divestment there are all manner of problems are cropping up, as you were alluding to. When Link divested the properties, we would maintain or step up communication. We would remind Link that when divestment occurs, they have to observe all the restrictive covenants and all the requirements. They have to pass on the message to the new buyers so that when the new buyer comes in, they will still abide by the covenants. Turning now to the other question, the agreement for sale and purchase and all the other documents. Maybe you were not part of the meeting when this was discussed. Mr. Atichu asked about the earlier days when the HA entered into an assignment deed with Link. We have made available the information by way of a CD-ROM. If Mr. Wan is so interested, the Secretariat can make them available. They dismantle some of the facilities, and then their responsibility would fall away. And there's a loophole there, isn't it? Deputy Director, we will look at the situation. If there is an equipment that has fallen apart, it has to be replaced, it has to be substituted, and we will look at
individual circumstances, if under the DMC they have to make available the facilities, we wouldn't force the DMC. We'll have a look at the situation. Right, the sale and purchase agreement, this has been transmitted to members, so you might wish to have a look. Right, so much for this meeting, and my thanks to the officials from the Housing Department. AOB, any other business? Mr. Etichu, Chairman, I noticed that item 7, there is a buyback arrangement for the facilities. Can we ask our research division to look at the overseas experience? This is in hand. This is in hand. I hope that this can be over and done with as soon as possible, and we may be made available to members. My grateful thanks, Chairman. Anything else? If not, that's it for today. Thank you very much.